I'm a photographer first of all. And from there, the other interest came from either how to develop my photography or how to use my photography. I think design very much came from how to use my photography. And film, and initially, of course, videos, came in a way from frustration in how people I photographed were shown by me in a certain way, and the videos that were made with them showed them very differently. And in my eyes, it was not in keeping with the depth of their work or the character of their work. It had a lot to do with how you think about images and what you want people to feel after you experienced either looking at a photograph or looking at a video. Now, I think I'm much more successful at photography side than video side, but it has influence on your photography, and your photography has influence on the other things. So it's very interesting for myself to see after many years, I can see suddenly in my photography more ideas came into place because I did videos where you had to work with ideas and at least you had to work with thinking of a story or storyline. You know. And when I looked at my first work that finished in the late 80s, which is, this is part of it, what hangs here, then I did more portraiture, but the Star Trek period, which had some changes from this period, but one of the changes was that it became more playful. And sometimes there were ideas in the photographs. And after that came more conceptual photography. I did a series of fake paparazzi shots, and then I did a series of self-portraits. They were much more conceptual. And what I do now actually goes back to this period again, because I think I find it suits me and suits my life, and there's so much conceptual photography about that I quite like the more basic part of photography again. It's easier for me to look at it now and realize what I was doing, but I was really trying to find myself. And it came from, I think not feeling any purpose in life, and music seems to be full of people that seemed like a promising world, to me. It seems to have some freedom, fun, depth, and yeah. And away from this religious environment I was very much brought into the world in. So as soon as I had a camera in my hands, it was my most obvious choice of subject matter, because it was the only thing I was interested in. I wasn't interested in photography per se. It was purely an excuse to go physically closer to a stage of a performance. I lived in a small town, so in the 70s everything was easy, there were not all these rules. And the thing is, if you're insecure and shy, you think that other people always look at you and think, why is he doing, that's how you think. That makes you very insecure if you walk into a space with people, because you always think, what are they thinking? And we moved in our summer holiday, school holiday. My father and mother, my father knew a job, and we moved to another city. So in school holidays, you don't know anybody, because your only friends are usually at school at that age. So this concert was in that holiday. It was a concert on the open air in the afternoon at this town, because it existed so many hundreds of years. And I was so shy that I thought, like, I can't go there on my own. Maybe 200, 300 people. You know. So I asked my father, can I borrow your camera? And because I had the camera, I felt that it's okay to walk to the front, because people will think, of course he goes to the front, he has a camera. I mean, it's a little mad, but I took about 10 pictures, because I was very careful, and then once I got them printed, I sent them to some magazine, and they printed it. And that for me was like, wow, this is what I'm going to do. You know, and this is John Martin. It was taken when I still lived in Holland, and I worked for a music magazine there, and they were doing an interview with John Martin, who was a great folk singer. Anyway, it was outside London, I think it was in Sussex somewhere, in 78. And we arrived there and he was ill, much as I am today. And he was wearing a kind of bathrobe, which was this. And, you know, we did some pictures with that. And interesting with John, I photographed him quite a few times over the years. And every time I came to see him, he would live with another woman further away from London in a smaller house. Every time it got smaller and further away. In the end, he ended up in Scotland. And then I got lost touch with him, but then he moved to Ireland in the end, where he died. But he had to pay so much alimony every time that he couldn't afford only smaller houses and in cheaper areas of England. It was quite funny. He was his own worst enemy. But yeah, beautiful man. If you listen to his songs, it has this really very fragile, high voice. And then, you know, he was always up for a fight. You know, it's this incredible contrast between this beautiful voice and this man who just wanted to fight himself or fight anything. You can see still the grain, because I developed it myself, and I was always eager to get quick results. I quite often developed it slightly too hot, and the grain became even stronger. But you know, I very much like it myself to have that grain in my pictures. But that was very difficult in the 70s. People didn't like that at all. You know, what I'm very happy about is that I felt with some pictures that I made in the 70s there was a strength to it. That no matter how much people criticize me, I still had some belief in it. And with all the doubts I have in my life, I'm surprised that I actually managed to feel that and held on to it. And now, you know, it's in all my museum shows. And so, you know, it's nice. But I remember sending it to the record company at the time. And in my bad English, I would call them later and you received my picture? And they were like, yeah, well, you can't even see his face. You know, that's such a stupid picture. What do you think this, what do you think he will think of it? But of course he loved that picture, the picture he loved most of anything. And he wanted to use it later on an album he did. But I mean, it's quite interesting what, how often what record companies think is good and what I think is good are very different things, and I had many fights in that sense. But fortunately, I always worked with artists who were very much in control, and they made the decision in the end what image would be used. But I'm also very happy actually for an image like this to exist outside anything official, you know, and I think that was really how I worked in the beginning. I reacted to official images of people, and I made a kind of underground version of something that I felt was closer to it all. And then with U2 and Miles Davis, these what I thought were underground became overground, and I found that a difficult period. because I felt that I wasn't sure what to react to anymore, but anyway, that's a different story.